Have you ever asked, God, how come there's people around me that are rich and abundant and prosperous and happy and having great lives, and yet I'm broke? Why do some who don't even follow you, they don't listen to you like the way I listen to you? Well, in this episode, I'm gonna share with you 7 biblical verses how God wants you to think about money, success, prosperity, life, wealth, and happiness in this episode of the 7-Figure Squad, starting in 3, 2, 1, let's go.
Never short stopping, now I'm winning like I'm Jeter. Steady through the rigor, yeah, I'm getting bigger. Was fighting in them trenches, now I'm making 7 figures like.
What's cracking, everybody? Money Smart Guy Matt Sapaula here, hailing to you from Dallas, Texas. And I'm super pumped up and excited about this episode because these specifically are 7 Bible verses that I've gone through my own personal Bible study and walk with Christ to help me unlock the key, the code, so to speak, to making $1 million. And if I can do it, shoot, so can you. But before we get started, our goal is to get to 150,000 subscribers because we want to award a church, charity, or nonprofit $5,000 on behalf of the 7-Figure Squad. So therefore, please, if you haven't done so already, please hit subscribe and share this episode with your friends and family. All right, let's get into these biblical verses. Number one, God gave you a choice about how you deal with money, how you deal with success, prosperity, your life. Let's talk about this and expose a biblical verse here in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 19. It reads like this. This day I call the heavens and the earth as witnesses against you that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life so that you and your children may live. See, God says choose. He gave it to you, blessings as well as curses. Now, it's up to you, the human being, the citizen of the kingdom of God, to say, you know what? I'm going to choose life. I'm going to choose an attitude about when it comes to money. I need to choose ownership of my choices and decisions and not lay blame on other people. You know, it's very often to see today, especially on social media, it's provided a platform for many people to rant, complain, my life sucks. I mean, there's even a hashtag for that type of stuff, right? My life sucks. Some other things that you might see online that I won't repeat here in this episode. But you see so many people out there, oh, my life sucks, this, and that. Complain, 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 complain. And do you know what gets a lot of eyeballs? Those headlines. That you are powerless, that you can't do anything, that you need to depend on somebody else. But get God say? What did God say? God says choose life, choose prosperity, choose the abundance, choose a better way of living your life to honor Him. Because your choices shape your brain. What am I talking about? It's even scientifically proven. And friends, guess what happens? Your thoughts and how you think about money, success, wealth, and prosperity eventually turns into actions, which leads you to point number 2. You gotta go opposite. If everybody's traveling a certain direction, doesn't necessarily mean you go in that same direction. Rethink the way you think. For example, if you thought you were doing something right, and then later found out that you were wrong, when would you want to know? Just because everybody's going this direction doesn't necessarily mean it's the right direction. The right direction for saving your money, investing your money, making money, it might be not the way destined for you. So therefore, if you're thinking about making millions of dollars, they say, hey, the way for you to make a lot of money is to go to college. Well, folks, I think we've kind of blown up after the experience here with the pandemic in the last 3, 4, 5 years. We found out, and it's becoming more mainstream, that if your outcome is to make $1 million, if your outcome is to be financially successful, college is one way to do it. It is not the end all, be all, but what is mainstream media telling you? What is the propaganda telling you? What are a lot of people, even in your friends and family, telling you? Go to college, go to college, go to college, because you're gonna be the first Johnson, you're gonna be the first Sanchez, you're gonna be the first Garcia, you're gonna be the first person in our entire family last name that's ever been to college. But at the end of the day, I ask myself this, forget going to college, I wanna be the first person in my family to become a first generation cash flow faith-based millionaire. But that was going opposite, you see? And not a lot of people were supporting me. But back to number one, I had a choice. I had a choice to say, family, friends, I love you, but necessarily I can't follow you. Why? Because none of you are financially successful. Let's take a look at what Romans chapter 12, verse 2 has to say about this. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. Friends, Seven Figure Squad, what do you think God's will is for your life? And oftentimes in churches, they don't talk about sex, they don't talk about politics, and they don't talk about money. And I'm so glad that you're a part of this YouTube channel now where we can openly discuss these three things that for some churches are very, very taboo. And specifically money. And if you're thinking about becoming financially free and financially independent, ask yourself this question. In your city and state, in the county that you live in, how much does it take to live, to have a house, to have food, to have transportation, to have childcare, to have education for your family, to pay your taxes, other necessities, and saving for your financial future? How much money does it take for a household of two adults, a couple kids? How much will it take? We were doing this exercise on IG Live the other night, and we had people from East Coast, Prince George's County, Maryland. We had people from Ventura County, California. We had people even from Maricopa County in Phoenix, Georgia. We did this research. How much money it takes for a family of two, a husband and wife, two adults, and four kids to live in those areas. You know what we found? Nothing less than $100,000 a year. Nothing less than six figures. And yet you think $15 an hour is gonna help you solve your financial problems? Friends, please choose and take ownership of your financial situation. Rethink why you think the way about money. Review the Bible many, many times. Review the things that inspire you many, many times. Let me ask you a question. What's your favorite movie to watch? One of my favorite movies to watch is The Gladiator. I love The Gladiator. I love watching that movie. I love watching the movie 300, Sparta, right? I love watching that movie. You know what I find? Every time I watch those movies, new things I've never seen before come up in the movie. Like, oh, I didn't notice that. Oh, I didn't notice that. I didn't know. Well, think about how your experiences as you're personally growing and developing when you're reading the Bible. That's why they call it the living word. Review scripture. Go opposite of what everybody's trying to tell you about finances and success, wealth, and prosperity, especially if they're not financially successful. And there's a part of your brain. It's called the reticular activator, the reticular activating system. It's part of your brain. We talked about the brain in point number one. There's another part of your brain that is activated when it starts focusing on certain things. So, for example, let's say I remember coming back from the military, and I was like, I'm so proud of my first car. It was an Oldsmobile Cutlass Supreme. And I'm like, man, nobody's got this car. I've seen this car, silver. I've never seen this before in Southern California, ever. I'm gonna be the only one that has this type of car. I pick it up for a few grand. I'm driving around base. Next thing you know, what do I find in the next week? Everybody and their mama is driving an Oldsmobile Cutlass Supreme, right? Why? Because I didn't notice it before. So therefore, if you're saying to yourself, hey, there's certain things about the Bible, there's certain things about money, I'm starting to study this subject matter. I'm choosing to reshape the way I think about money. I'm choosing ownership. I'm choosing to go in the past why certain opportunities I looked over and that possibly could have been a mistake. There's certain relationships I looked over and that possibly could have been a mistake because now you're affecting the reticular activating system of your brain. Oftentimes people make a bad decision without realizing the context or the opportunity that they're in, realizing that opportunity right then and there is the relationship and the accountability and the blueprints and the access to absolutely changing their life. But they're so distracted with life. They're so distracted with other things. Why? Because they didn't choose to go opposite. Lord, close certain doors. Lord, remove certain relationships. And you send me with faith and expectation that God is going to answer your prayer. And guess what starts happening? Boom, prayers start being answered. And when you're looking at this whole process, the reticular activating system is a very powerful thing. So there's not only a spiritual thing, but God made your brain to act a certain way. It's meant to be molded and shaped. Well, that's what Romans says. Don't be conformed to the patterns of this world, but be renewed by the transforming of your mind. So therefore, a couple affirmations I'd love for you guys, if you're watching this video up to this point, please put in the comment section below these affirmations. I am going opposite. I am going opposite. Here's another affirmation I'd like to put down in the comment section if you're following our episode thus far. I am making the right choices with my money. I am making the right choices with my money. Put in the comment section below if you affirm that in your life. All right, let's go to point number three. God gave you the spirit of power Let's look at 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. It reads like this. For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. Ooh, the last one is pretty tough. You love to receive power. You love to receive love, but you don't like to receive or invoke self-discipline. Well, here's the thing. God has also told us to not fear. I believe there's over 365 verses of do not fear in the Bible, which means God does not want you to walk every day in fear, but in power, in love, and in self-discipline. So there's strength in God's word. There's strength in God's name. There's strength in doing what you're doing on behalf of the kingdom of God. It's because you're invoking the fact that God is faithful and he's abundant. He wants to be fruitful in your tithings and offerings. He wants to be helpful in you getting to the next level in your financial life. So therefore, you can glorify and magnify him, that when people see you, they don't see your millions. They see the glory of God shining to you and through you in the strength of that climb. Number four, God also has given us the generational blessings and curses. What? God gave us generational blessings and curses. Are you kidding me? Let's take a look at this scripture right here. Let's look at Exodus chapter 34, verse 7. It reads like this. And he passed in front of Moses proclaiming, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children and their children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation. Yo, what is crazy here, right? In other words, you got a choice to live a blessed life, an obedient life, or you can have a choice to live a sinful life. Now, you can get away with it, all good. However, you have to understand that how you think about money, how you think about success in your life, prosperity, wealth, and happiness will be fed to your children. You can feed them the good teachings, or you can feed them the curses that's inside the Bible, that's inside the financial realm of this current world. Because also science shows us this weird word I was researching. It's called epigenetics. Epigenetics. In other words, there's things that you do in your life that inside your DNA, it's passed on to the next generation. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. So, for example, in my family, sadly, we have addicts. And through some of our family members, we've been through the 12 steps, the Alcohol Anonymous 12-step program. Here's the thing, too, as well, is that they found that addiction is actually passed in the DNA from one generation to another. Guys, take a look at these articles. Take a look at some of these articles you need to do research in. This is called epigenetics. They're finding out how you're actually either passing on blessings or passing on curses. And it's inside scripture. What are you choosing? Back to number one. Are you taking ownership of your situation? Because God gave you choice. Which leads you to point number five. Catch and release. Catch and release. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. It reads like this. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. Woo! Every thought, not some thoughts. Now, how many thoughts do you think you have in a day? Shoot, how many thoughts do you think you have in the drive to work? How many thoughts do you have in the morning, in the afternoon, during lunch, in the evening, at the gym, in church? How many thoughts do you have? Scripture says take every thought and make it captive. Now, here's the thing. Are all your thoughts pure? Are all your thoughts positive? Are some of your thoughts negative? Well, here's the thing too as well. You have choice to make sure you have all those thoughts captive to the Lord. You say, Lord, I have a negative thought here about this. This is a sinful thought. Lord, take this thought captive. That's up to you. If it's a positive thought, Lord, take this captive out to you. It deals with not only your self-talk. Do you talk yourself out of a good situation? Do you talk yourself out of opportunity? Do you talk yourself that you're not worthy of being a millionaire? Do you talk yourself that, oh, Matthew, I'm a Christian. I'm a Christian. Money smart guy. I'm not a Christian. It's not very Christian-like to be wealthy. It's not very Christian-like to be rich. It's not very Christian-like to be a millionaire. Are you serious? Are you serious? That when you become a millionaire, you don't think you're more of a giver and a provider, a tither, a kingdom builder? You don't think that way? When more people make money because you're making money, because you're investing in their companies, you're investing in their businesses, you're investing in their education, you're investing in their growth, you don't think people are blessed because of your obedience to be prosperous and take control of your choices when it relates to money and opportunity. So when it comes to your prayer, your meditation, and affirmations, which we've been doing a little bit of that exercise today, all those thoughts you want to maintain captive to God. God, listen, you created me to be on this earth. Of all the sperm cells that were competing to fertilize the egg, I won. Hey, science, man, science. And it's a miracle that you're here. It's a miracle that you're here. You believe that today? It's a miracle that you're here. Okay, if it's a miracle that you're here, then what are you doing about that miracle? And some of you have multiple miracles in your life because there's certain things in your life that could have taken you out, that could have killed you, and yet you're still here watching this video. You're a miracle. So what are you doing with this miracle? What are you doing with this blessing? And here's the thing too as well. Oftentimes when it comes to the subject of money, when it comes to the subject of making your first $100,000 a year, $250,000 a year, being debt-free, being credit card debt-free, being student loan debt-free, taking care of your mom, your dad, your parents, your in-laws, the people you love and care about, often it's very, very, very emotional. You're very emotional about that. But here's the thing, when emotions are high, logic is low. However, when you're a little bit more rational and your logic, because you've taken those thoughts captive to what's positive and removed those that are negative, that the Lord took those negative thoughts and removed them from your mindset and your spirit set, then let's, you know, you can be a little bit more logical and pragmatic about what God wants to do in your life. When emotions are low, logic is high. When logic is low, emotions are high. Let's go to point number 6. Focus on the positive, not the negative. Let's go to Philippians verse 4, chapter 8. It reads like this. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Brothers and sisters watching this video right now, do you think it's praiseworthy? Do you think it's noble that you become a millionaire? Yes. Do you think it's right? Do you think it's pure that you're now a bigger blessing to the kingdom? You're a bigger blessing to your family, that you are now putting them in schools that you never thought you'd put your kids in schools, and to have access to education opportunity that you never had access to as a kid growing up? That the opportunity that they're asking for, that you can fund and finance it with money, that is praiseworthy. That is something to be thinking about. Oftentimes I see in a faith-based community, oh my gosh, man, you know, prosperity gospel this, prosperity gospel. Listen, guys. Prosperity is in the Bible. It's not a gospel. Prosperity is in the Bible. God wants you to win. God wants you to succeed. God wants you to be wealthy and successful, to be a bigger blessing to other people. It's not just getting it for the material good. It's not what I'm talking about. It's just not for material success. It's just not for stuff and status. It's for purpose. So when you're looking at how you focus on the positive and negative, one of my personal behaviors when it comes to bad situations is, boom, gratitude. You know, the last 30 days in my life, to be honest and transparent, I've had a lot of losses in the last 30 days. Lost this, lost that, lost this, lost out on this, lost out on this. Family members, COVID, pandemic, all these different things, losses. People passed away, losses. Opportunities taken away, losses. I've had losses. We weren't having certain numbers that we had in September. We just lost it in October. Okay. Hey, we had a bad month. And guess what? I'm grateful. Thank you, Lord, for bestowing upon me this opportunity to bring praise and honor upon you. Lord, if I took my eye off you, what do I need to learn from you? What do I need to be inspired by? What do I need to be led by you in? And let God do his thing with you. So when you're looking at whatever you choose, positive or negative, is your reality. Whatever's positive or negative is your reality. For example, have you ever met somebody with the Midas touch? That whatever they do, successful. Like, goodness gracious, man, do you do anything that's bad? No, you know why? Because their thoughts are, you know what, if I'm gonna do something, I'm gonna do it well. If I'm gonna do something, I want to maximize my opportunity. If I'm gonna do something, I'm going to bring glory and honor to God. It's just not the $1 million. It's just not the recognition. It's, hey, I'm giving honor to God. That if I don't express myself fully in the spirit of the Lord, it's a disrespect to the kingdom. That I'm showing everybody that, you know, God really isn't that important in my life and in the world. And I think right now in this day and age, guess what the world needs a large dose of? That reminder. When you're looking at all the things that people do, the opportunities that people are involved in, you can have that mighty touch. How? By you being grateful about the situation you're in. I often tell people this: if you find yourself in the worst position, you're actually in the best position, because God wants to know what you're gonna do right in the middle. If you find yourself in the worst position, you're actually in the best position. Please affirm with me, if you feel that your life is gonna get ahead because you're gonna focus on the positive, not the negative, please put this affirmation in the comment section below. I am grateful about where I am and where I'm going. I am grateful about where I am and where I'm going. And let me encourage you today, for those of you watching this episode. I don't care if you're broke. I don't care if you're laid off. I don't care if you just went through a divorce or sadly lost somebody that you loved and care about, or you've lost your money, your 401k, your business due to COVID. I get it. I totally understand. All I care about is you're reminded of this. I don't care where I'm at right now, man. I care about where I'm going, because God is leading me there, and everybody's going to see how good God is in my life, because when I get there, everybody's going to know about Him. Amen? All right, let's go on to the last point, number 7. Thoughts, again, become things. Thoughts become things. Let's look at Proverbs chapter 23, verse 7. It reads like this. It says, "Do not eat the bread of a miser, nor desire in his delicacies. For as he thinks in his heart, so is he. Eat, drink, he says to you, but his heart is not with you." Because in this context, somebody's always thinking about, oh my gosh, you're eating. Yeah, I'm giving you, but yeah, I'm thinking about the cost. So he's not really giving you. Because when you're really giving to somebody, think about this. The way God wants you to give is you give to somebody without any expectation in return, okay? Without any expectation in return. You give because you give, because you are a wise steward. In other words, money that's not necessarily yours, it's God's money. He's just trusting you with it and what you're gonna do with it. So therefore, what you do with the least, he can bless you with the most. So as a person, as a wise steward, if you're giving, give to somebody. So in this context of the scripture, it said, listen, don't eat with the miser, because the miser is always worrying about money. He's always worrying about costs. So he's really not giving. They're always penny pinching. It's so annoying. However, when you sit down and you're eating with somebody, and say, listen, man, dude, I got this. And I don't expect you to pick up lunch. I don't expect you to pick up lunch down the road. I got this lunch because I enjoy your company. Okay? That's the way you want to give. But scripture says, hey, listen, these things that you're thinking about, as a man thinketh, so is he. Thoughts become things. You have to ask yourself this question. How come trends become trends? How come fashion becomes fashion? How come shoes become shoes that everybody wears? How come people are so enamored by pop culture and things that are trending right now that are in style today? How many times do you go to TikTok and it's a trending song, or it's a trending dance, or it's a trending whatever? Why is it trending? You know why? Because people see it over and over and over. And over and over and over and over again. Now it's a thing. Even if it was weird at first. Like, for example, a lot of people are early adopters. For example, when a lot of people went to the Bitcoin, it's weird. It's weird. Why am I doing it? It's not promoted. It's not talked a lot about. So a lot of people didn't move on it. A lot of people think about making money early on in your careers in your 20s and 30s. Just get a job, be secure, get your benefits. They weren't talking about, listen, you need to get a plan and a blueprint and a mentor and a platform, so therefore you can be a first generation cash flow millionaire. They're not talking about that type of stuff. Why? Because it's not trending. Becoming a millionaire is not trending. But by the way, the way things are going with inflation and the cost of goods and services and things just costing more money, guess what? Eventually you will have to start earning $1 million. So therefore you have the financial flexibility and freedom to do what it is that you want, honor God with your finances, and live the life that you feel that God led you to believe. So what you talk about, you be about. What you talk about, you be about. So what are the repetitive things that you're talking about? What are the repetitive things that you are reading about? What are the repetitive things that you're feeding, consuming your senses with? And guess what? Sometimes bad things are in fashion, bad things are in music. When I'm listening to the kids' music, I'm paying attention to the lyrics. Why? Because I don't want my kids subconsciously being fed the wrong thing. Why? Because thoughts become things. And I'm wondering why they're acting a certain way. I wonder why I'm acting a certain way. So I'm conscious too about the things that I'm hearing, I'm listening to, the things that I'm watching and understanding and investing my time with, because you can either spend time with things or you can invest time with things. You can get a return back on this investment that's going to appreciate when you put time into it, or you're just spending just to spend. Again, back to point number one, God is giving that choice up to you. So as I wrap up, a few questions I want you to ask yourself. Number one, who am I? Who am I? What is exactly that I want? Now, these are 7 Bible verses that made me a millionaire. Do you want to be a millionaire? Do you want to be a person making 6 figures? Do you want a person that just wants to double your income? You want to go from $30,000 to $60,000? Or are you already a millionaire? You want to go from $1 million to $2 million, or $2 million to $4 million? What is it that you want? Are you clear about that? And more importantly, who are you associating with? Because in Proverbs, it also said that good character is corrupted by bad company. Second question I'm asking you is, what books are you reading? And again, music are you listening to? What books are you reading and music are you listening to? It may sound corny, but I fall asleep to a certain amount of music to program my mind to be grateful, to expand my my healing process of my body, to expand the understanding of the things and subject matters I'm thinking about through subconscious programming. It sounds corny, but I wake up in the morning and I say certain things like, where'd I get that from? Oh, it was the meditation music I was listening to, the affirmation I was listening to last night. And by the way, there's some very simple things you can listen to on your iTunes. If you go to iTunes, you look for Millionaire Affirmations, knock yourself out, biblical affirmation. You can learn the whole entire Bible by just listening to the affirmations at night, self-program yourself. And again, it may sound corny, but hey, it works for me. And potentially it can make it happen and work for you. Third thing, what are you implementing? It's one thing to watch this video. It's one thing to read a book. It's another thing to watch another video. It's another thing to read another book. But are you implementing? Because in the implementation process, that's when you're actually learning and expressing. When you're implementing, you're actually learning and expressing, you're growing, and you're manifesting. So that being said, guys, a couple of videos for you to watch. Number one, how one biblical principle helped my friend Daniel Kwok go from broke to $8 million in real estate. Watch this video right here. And the second video here is three biblical principles that made me a first-generation cash flow millionaire. If you haven't done so already, guys, please drop me your thoughts, your comments, your questions in the comment section below. And again, if you're watching this on Facebook, please click like and follow the business page, Money Smart Guy. If you're watching this on YouTube, make sure you click subscribe, hit notifications to be alerted the next time we upload our next episode. From Dallas, Texas, I'm your Money Smart Guy, and until we meet again, continue to live smart, continue to love smart, and be money smart today. God bless you guys. Bye-bye.